What's up, guys? Welcome back. This is Probing Paul, episode number 95, my monthly Q&A series, which, despite what you might have heard, is usually a painless procedure. However, sometimes I forget to check in on a monthly basis. My last probing was actually in June, so I am overdue. So without further ado, let's get started.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise. Tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumb screw for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumb screw for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. A very quick note on how this works before we get started. There is a Probing Paul playlist that's linked in the video's description, and we also often begin by looking down this long tunnel at previous times when I was probed. So many memories. This month's questions were all taken from recent comments on recent videos, beginning with this question from PGBiscuit4531. What AMD card should I get if I want something with similar performance to an RTX 4070? A deceptively simple question, but one that, in order to answer properly, you have to start out by saying, well, let me explain a few things first. And if you're trying to convince someone to buy an AMD card instead of an NVIDIA card, the last thing you want to have to do is explain some caveats that they need to keep in mind, because NVIDIA is by far the market leader in terms of market share. This has been recently reaffirmed and re-updated by the most recent Steam hardware survey. This is for August 2025, by the way, and you can see there's just lots and lots of NVIDIA cards in terms of what's up at the top. Even when you start to get to some AMD and Intel stuff, these are generally integrated graphics, which are much more common for devices like laptops. As you can see here, the RTX 5070 has recently climbed to the top of the most recently launched GPUs, the RTX 50 series from NVIDIA. It has actually gained a lot of ground on the RTX 4070. The 4070 is not in production anymore, so if you're looking for this tier of card, you're probably going to be opting for the RTX 5070, which has an MSRP of $550. The Tech PowerUp GPU database is a great resource for just getting a quick, at-a-glance look at GPUs that might be in the same performance ballpark as what you're looking at. So if we check out the RTX 4070 entry, we can scroll down here to relative performance, and here we can quickly see that the RTX 5070 does have some gains over the 4070, not as much as I would have liked, but it's about 11% faster, at least according to the TPU database. The cards that fall into this category would be between $500 and $600 in terms of the price you pay. And ideally you'd want something that is at least as performant, if not better, than the RTX 4070. Even better than the 5070 would also be even better. So while yes, there's Radeon RX 6950 XT and 6900 XT here, those are now two generations old, which also means they're gonna be harder to find at retail. There is the RX 7900 GRE, which is right there in the same range as the 4070. And that's a card that I totally would recommend if you could actually buy it. But jumping over to PC Part Picker, we find that really you can't, at least if you want to buy it directly from a retailer in the US right now. The step up from there and the current generation card that I would be really excited to recommend if the pricing was what we were told it would be the RX 9070, which you can see is a nice jump up both over the 4070 and the 5070. However, once again, if you've been following my GPU Price Watch series, you probably know that the 9070 and 9070 XT are still $50 to $100 over what they should be, over what AMD told us they would be selling for. And sure, you could say, well, Paul, at least they're not like 900 or 700 or whatever they were like 3 or 4 months ago. But by comparison, the RTX 5070 has come down in price from its original markups, and now you can buy it for MSRP. And I'm not saying the MSRP pricing is great for the RTX 50 series. We had plenty of complaints about that back when the cards were launching in January, February, and March. But that is what is available, that is current generation, that you can actually buy from a retailer if you're not considering the secondary market or the used market. Even in just the week plus since I posted the GPU Price Watch video, we now have 5070s selling for lower than MSRP. Granted, you need a Prime membership for this particular deal, but that still feels more like back to sort of normal GPU pricing. There's like, here's what the GPUs should cost, and then if you wait a little bit of time, maybe there'll be some deals and some prices will come down to below what the MSRP was originally. But meanwhile, if we look at RX 9070s stubbornly, obstinately refusing to drop below even $600, which is $50 higher than the MSRP that AMD promised. And the same goes for the RX 9070 XT, but worse, they are $700 instead of $600. So it is no surprise that amongst the GPUs that are actually listed on the Steam Hardware Survey, there are no current-gen RX 9000 series graphics cards. I mean, there are, but they are grouped under the other category because there are so few of them that they're just grouped together in the other category. So while I would like to tell people, like I did in the build video I did a couple months back, to opt for the 9070 or 9070 XT, right now I just don't think they're compelling values at the current prices that you can buy them for, and I would point people towards an RTX 5070 if you're spending between $500 and $550. And it is really quite frustrating for me because when the 9070 and 9070 XT launched, I was pleasantly surprised, at least in particular with the 9070 XT. I was ready to tell people, hey, here's a great card from AMD, an excellent alternative to Nvidia because of all of their shenanigans with how they price things and how they present things and how they can often be very deceptive with their consumer communication. But that's like a point of principle. And when it comes down to like a real world recommendation for someone, it always falls to what is the best value you can get. And for that, that's the 5070 right now. All right, next question comes from Wooski1. Can a man get a BackConnect AM5 board in black yet? Why are they all white? Is this to upsell white GPUs and cases? I already have a nice case and a GPU. No need to apologize here, Wooski. And in fact, I'm going to apologize because if you watched my Computex 2023 coverage when the back to front connector thing first sort of debuted, I was pretty negative about it. Now, I've come around a bit since a lot of case manufacturers have come on board. There are a lot more cases now that are more compatible with a wider, somewhat more universal reverse connector motherboard standard. And now you have the big three at least, Asus, MSI, and Gigabyte, who are all manufacturing boards and sometimes cases as well that meet those standards. So if you really don't like the look of cables, you can hide them in the backside of the motherboard. And practically speaking, for me, it can make some builds easier, particularly with plugging in stuff like your 8-pin supplemental CPU power connectors. I'm still not the biggest fan of this solution. This is proprietary to Asus. This is the power connector that routes 600 watts of power through your motherboard and into your graphics card. And that's mainly because you lose interoperability with that type of connector. Newer Asus models, they've been toying around with having that connector be swappable, so you can actually unplug it, and that means your graphics card would still be compatible with other motherboards that didn't have that connector in the future. So adjustments have been made, so the reverse connector motherboards I am now more accepting of. But I understand your dilemma that if you want to build on AM5 right now, which is what most DIY builders are doing, because in my opinion, and I think a lot of people agree with me, it's just a better platform versus what Intel has available. But most of the reverse connector motherboards either have a color scheme that is not that sort of dark stealth black aesthetic, or they're simply just not AMD motherboards. There's actually quite a few more Intel motherboards that have this standard. So I set out on a mission to just answer the question, like, what AMD motherboards are there that support the reverse connectors? And so I did a hunt on MSI, Gigabyte, and Asus to find that out. I discovered that MSI is like the only manufacturer that actually lets you do that search. But of course, if you're looking for AMD and reverse connectors, they only have three models available, and as you can see, none of these are black, which I think is the original complaint. There are reverse connector AMD motherboards, but they all fall into the white aesthetic, and which is great for people who want to build that kind of system. And perhaps the decision to do this was because those white PCs really stand out when they get video and stuff like that. They think they do well with RGB if you're into that aesthetic. But if you wanted to go for a stealthy black PC with either no RGB or maybe just some minimal soft like white lighting or something like that, on the Gigabyte website, if you actually go to their motherboard products like listings and you try to drill down there, you're not able to sort for the reverse connector Gigabyte motherboards. They are called Project Stealth. MSIs are called Project Zero. Asus is called BTF, which I think they originally stood for back to front, which is backwards because they're actually going from front to back. But then I guess maybe they retconned it at some point to actually stand for back to future. But anyway, at least here we can click on motherboards and see the motherboards that are available. And here we can see that yes, the one black Project Stealth motherboard they have is an Intel chipset. And not even a new Intel chipset, it's a Z690. They do have a couple AMD options, a B650E and a B850, but again, that white ice theme finished is what you're getting from both Gigabyte and MSI. And then there is Asus, and Asus, like, they have so many products. They have so many drill down options you can choose from here. You can even do form factor, but there really is no way to just look for Asus BTF motherboards. Even if you do a search for BTF, it does not come up with all of them. The tough boards that they have did not pop up. So anyway, I'm just gonna cut this one short and say, yes, there is one. And it was actually just announced a couple weeks ago. This is the Asus ROG Crosshair X870E Hero BTF edition. Supposedly launched in mid-August per some articles that went up at the time and a press release. Pretty clean looking board. I've used the ASUS X870E Hero non-BTF edition. It's a good board, but it is very expensive. I believe it starts at $500. So at least at the end of my search, I thought to myself, well, at least I have an answer for you. There is one option that's out there, but with it being the X870E Hero, which is currently selling for $642 on Newegg if you wanna buy it directly, it seems to have been a paper launch, a vaporware launch. While this product was announced, I cannot find it for sale anywhere, at least at the major retailers in the US where I would expect to see it listed. So Wooski, I guess the answer to your question is, is no. No, you can't just get a black AM5 motherboard with reverse connectors. I guess you're just gonna have to suck it up and actually have visible cables in your build, or you're just gonna have to wait longer, at least until that particular set of features doesn't have the premium pricing that you must pay for an ASUS Crosshair Hero motherboard. All right, a couple more questions. These are a little bit shorter and perhaps less tech-related. Richard Phillips 1066 says, has anyone noticed that Paul's hair on his arms is longer than the hair on his face and head? FYI, just an observation, not a jab. I'm almost hairless and quite jealous. I've only discussed my body hair a few times on the channel, but I will fully admit that you're totally correct. My arm hair does have quite a bit of body, a bit of volume. Of course, I have to use the proper cleaning and conditioning methods, but it does come in useful. If I remember washing my hands like in a public restroom or something like that, and they don't have like towels or like a dryer available, I can just kind of go like this, you know? Just dry out the hands a little bit on the arm hair. It helps, you know, disperse the liquid and helps it evaporate. It's somewhat reminiscent of PC water cooling, I think. At least that's how I'm trying to tie this question back to the general theme of my channel. But it's also a good reminder, just in general, if my head hair ever gets longer than my arm hair, then I know, oh, it's time for a haircut, which I do myself. Okay, last question is from Paolo Presti 9568. Thank you for your compliments on the video. And in fact, this is a compliment, not a question. So I included it in this video, not because it is a good question, but because it is a nice reminder of why I do what I do. Because stories like this make me feel warm and fuzzy and validated inside. Because there are lots of people who don't necessarily follow PC hardware all the time, like Paolo Presti, built their first desktop PC in 2013, still using it now 5 days a week, running Windows 11 24H2 on it even. Done a few upgrades, replaced the SSD and the memory, had 4 monitors connected to it as well. And just about coming around to the point where another PC build is looking like it might happen pretty soon. I love this because it's like a very nice, long, healthy amount of time to use the same PC. And I would always say, and perhaps I don't say this often enough, if you have a PC that is functional and getting the job done for you, then by all means, keep using it. You do not need to upgrade every cycle, and you do not need to have that FOMO of having like the latest graphics card and CPU and all that. Although I know I do lots of videos on the newest stuff that comes out, but I try to balance that between like more reasonable recommendations at the same time. But anyway, Paolo Presti 9568, I think you have at least picked a good time to do an upgrade. GPU prices have settled down quite a lot from the beginning of the year, and there's lots of really good options on the market. Most of those, at least on the platform side, are with AMD. But also, upgrading from a PC that was first built in 2013, you're gonna see such a night and day performance difference that is also very satisfying as well. But hopefully that is a satisfying end to this video. I wanna say thank you to all of these people who posted comments and questions. Thank you to you guys for posting your comments and questions down below. Down in the video's description, you can find a link to the stories and articles and websites that I referenced today, as well as a link to my store at paulshardware.net where you can buy yourself some high quality merchandise to help support the channel. If you enjoyed this video and you want to hit the thumbs up button on your way out, that's greatly appreciated as well. Subscribe if you're not already. We'll see you all in the next video.